And the final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 8901 in the name of Claire Adamson on Drowning Prevention Week 2023. The debate will be concluded without any questions being posed. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Claire Adamson to open the debate around 7 minutes. Ms. Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I firstly thank my colleagues who signed the motion to allow this debate to take place this afternoon, and also those who have persevered to the bitter end to be here to hear the debate this afternoon. It is an honour to open a final debate ahead of summer recess. Drowning Prevention Week took place last week, but due to parliamentary business, we were not able to hold the debate during the week itself, but its message is every bit as crucial. The purpose of the initiative, now in its 10th year, is to reduce the number of drownings and near drownings that occur in the UK every year by promoting the skills and knowledge that people need to be safe and have fun in the water. We have, thankfully, entered warmer months, and people are understandably excited about enjoying Scotland's globally recognised coastlines and waterways. But it is imperative that we recognise the risks that come around water. On average, 50 people accidentally drown in Scotland each year, and we know this is a very high figure in comparison. Sadly, I'm sure that we've seen the stories recently of tragedies around water, and that emphasises the importance of messaging around Drowning Prevention Week as we enter the summer months. Awareness raising is a critical aspect of the messaging, so for posterity and to get it on the record yet again, I will give some of the pertinent water advice that's available. Cold water shock. It's an involuntary response to the body suddenly being unexpectedly immersed into water, which is a temperature of less than 15 degrees, which can occur in summer in Scotland. Water Safety Scotland and Scottish Fire and Rescue Service advise that if you unintentionally fall into water, do not try to swim right away. Fight your instinct to swim or thrash about. Try to remain calm, relaxed, turn onto your back and adopt a starfish float position. Once floating, the initial effects of cold water shock will pass in about 90 seconds. Then call for help and look for anything that you can use to help you get out of the water. And even if you do get out of the water, please remember that there is a risk of hypothermia, and emergency services should be called if people are exposed to severe cold water. Of course, this is an event of getting into difficulty, but as with all accident prevention, the safest way to proceed is to be proactive and be prepared. If you're going to be in or around water, check the conditions, ensure you're not alone, and bring appropriate gear and follow the advice on any equipment that you may be using. Heeding these tips could be the difference between life and death. Free information resources are provided by the fantastic organisations like the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, Water Safety Scotland and the Royal Life Saving Society, RLSS, which coordinates Drowning Prevention Week. Indeed, RLSS's 2022 Insight report clearly shows that public awareness of risk and safety is lacking. RLSS analysed 240 accidental drownings, and 49% of the people who lost their lives could swim. 73% of those fatalities occurred in the absence of professional supervision, and it shows how much work we have to do. These safety resources often include vital advice aimed at individuals, but we as legislators should examine the wider policy context. I'm pleased to say that water safety, indeed all safety policy, has found increased prominence in Scottish political landscape. I believe that is in no small part due to the dedicated campaigning of the members of the cross-party group on accident prevention and safety awareness, which I convene. I'm very privileged to do so. The group have seen at first hand the impact that our members have had across the Parliament's policy discussions. Water Safety Scotland, who were formed for the networking at the CPG, have conducted an interim review of Scotland's drowning prevention strategy following tangible results. Its annual report shows that water-based fatalities decreased in Scotland last year and that there were fewer people accidentally drowning. Last year, there were 96 water-related fatalities recorded, with 45 of these being considered accidental drownings. While this decline is down to hard partnership working to raise awareness of water safety, any death is a tragedy and we cannot rest on our laurels. The policy work in this area has also resulted in Water Safety Scotland launching a new educational resource in April, which includes free water safety lessons for schools and practitioners. These materials are the first ever curriculum-aligned water safety resource. Scotland is the only UK nation to have water safety education embedded in the national curriculum. A welcome and important step. Work is ongoing both nationally and locally. I'm delighted to say that in North Lanarkshire, South Lanarkshire as well, we have a partnership approach to water safety, a PAWS group. My office had recently contacted the group about Christopher's Saving Lives campaign. The extraordinary campaign started by Dungan and Margaret Spears following the death of their son, Christopher, in drowning. Lifebelt ropes have been installed along the Clyde, which borders my beautiful constituency. And because of their dedication, their unique colour-coded safety rope is a simple but effective measure against vandalism or theft of crucial safety equipment. I wholeheartedly endorse the campaign and encourage local authorities to engage with it. I would just want to finally mention, Presiding Officer, the Drowning Incident Review, or DIR. This again has come from Partnership Working. DIR is a world-first programme which aims to gather data and understand the contributory factors of an incident to help gain better understanding of how to prevent further similar incidents. A DIR can be used for fatal incidents in both inland and coastal waters, and also for near-miss incidents, where these are either attended by emergency services or are reported. The process created by Scottish Fire and Rescue Service and RoSPA via Water Safety Scotland has finished its pilot and evaluation phase. And we recently heard the group's research at our cross-party group. Finally, Presiding Officer, please be safe, enjoy the water, and I open an invitation to everyone in the communities across Scotland to attend Helix Park on the 25th of July for World Drowning Prevention Day. Bigger and better last year, which was the biggest event in the country. It's a wonderful day for families to engage in water safety issues. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Adamson. And I call Pam Gosell to be followed by Christine Graham in 4 minutes, please, Ms Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm honoured to be contributing in today's debate, important debate, marking Drowning Prevention Week 2023, and I welcome the member Claire Adamson's motion today. In recent weeks, we have been reminded of just how unpredictable and unforgiving the water can be, from the lives taken in the Titan submarine, including that of Suleiman Dawood, a student at the University of Strathclyde, as well as the tragic drowning of Nicola Bulley after she accidentally fell into the cold water. These lives lost serve as a tragic reminder of the importance of water safety. The latest data from Water Safety Scotland shows that in 2021, there was an increase in overall water-related fatalities in comparison to previous years. As the West of Scotland MSP, I have some of the finest lochs and reservoirs in my region, including Loch Lomond. But with that comes a higher risk of drowning and accidental fatalities. Last year, I met with Loch Lomond Rescue Boat at Balloch, where I heard about the life experiences of the highly trained volunteer crew who at that time responded to around 80 call-outs per year. When I got in touch with them recently, they wanted to draw my attention to walk-in tragedies, which account for a large proportion of drownings in Loch Lomond. These are incidents where an individual walks in for a paddle or on a gently sloping shore, which suddenly drops off steeply. The cold water shock, combined with the panic and an inability to swim, can then result in rapid drowning. These accidents occur quickly, and if no help is immediately, they may result in fatalities. But chances of survival are increased by wearing flotation devices or holding on to flotation device. Education, however, is key to reducing the number of deaths. And I welcome today Claire Addison speaking about all the great work that's happening for water safety and education in schools. Giving an example, the ability to swim should be part of every school's curriculum, and all adults who cannot swim should be heavily encouraged to learn to do so. Presiding officer, more than 4 in 10 children leave primary school in Scotland unable to swim. And so I hope that the Scottish Government will prevent the closure of local swimming pools and the cancellation of free swimming lessons by ensuring that the local governments are sufficiently funded. Secondly, the dangers of the water need to be more widely publicised, given a significant number of walk-in drownings at Loch Lomond involve foreign visitors. And the final point I would like to touch on is that the need for members in this chamber to help local lifeboats operating as effectively as possible. Loch Lomond Rescue Boat have been trying to move their base for years to reduce response times, but are being held up by the Scottish Enterprise. Administrative hold-ups are unacceptable when everyone agrees that that water safety is a priority. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I'm honoured to have contributed to today's debate marking Drowning Prevention Week. Volunteers work tirelessly patrolling Scotland's waters, no doubt saving countless lives. But they cannot do the impossible, and it is the duty of members in this chamber to help in every way we can. We can do so by fighting for swimming pools and lessons to remain open and accessible, and by supporting local lifeboats like the Loch Lomond Rescue Boat to operate effectively in our respective areas.
Thank you, Ms Gosell. I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Jackie Bailey. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I congratulate Claire Addison on securing this debate and her long-standing commitment to this issue. In my constituency, we have many inland waterways which historically powered local industries. In the borders of the River Tweed and Gala Water turned the looms in the knitting and weaving sheds. And in Penicuik, the River Esk powered the paper mill, while the reservoirs in the Pentlands keep the water on tap in the city. These industries are long gone, but the rivers and waterways flow on with other uses, often leisure. But they are not always benign, and often more lethal in the sleepy summer months. Like reservoirs, the river waters can be bitterly cold when the sun blazes on. 4 people died from accidents in water in the Scottish borders in 2021, including Elise Murray, 15, from Kelso, who died whilst kayaking with her dad and brother in the River Tweed, and 90-year-old Jack Reed, who died after getting into difficulty in the River Tweed near Innerleithen. There were no water fatalities reported in 2022 in the Scottish borders. Following those tragic deaths in 2021, Scottish Fire and Rescue Service ran a water safety initiative centred around the River Tweed to educate the public. Flyers were posted at over 40 locally known areas for swimmers and other water-based activities giving advice on water safety. A water safety event was held at the River Tweed in Kelso, where water rescue teams performed live rescues and scenes in front of the public, highlighting the importance of their actions should they themselves get into difficulty into the water. Additionally, what they can do to help others, including to deploy lifebelts. Learning to swim and to swim safely is another aid. I'm pleased to say the new Gala Academy will have a swimming pool, as will the replacement Beeslack Secondary in Penicuik. Both Peebles and Penicuik High already have access to swimming pools nearby. But swimming is only part of the safety that to take for prevention. Inland waters in particular, as I've indicated, can be pretty risky. I can speak from experience, as I had to instill water safety into my 2 young sons at the very earliest of ages. We lived in a cottage in Minigaff in Galloway, where the sunny back garden ran down to meet 2 rivers, the Penkiln and beyond that the River Cree. Beyond that, there was the Lade, which had powered a mill. I knew that to forbid my sons to go near the rivers would make them even more attractive. So day in and day out, we walked along the banks with Roosty, our Irish setter, to observe the rivers in their seasonal moods. With their friends, they would play in the Penkiln in the summer holidays, building a dam to make a pool large enough to swim in. If I dipped my toe in, I can testify the water was icy cold, but incidentally good for cooling an evening libration of Chardonnay. The boys were immune to the temperature, and over the summer months the river would run so low the dorsal fins of the trout would rise above the watermark. So it was on a hot summer's day while I was pottering about in the kitchen, Angus, my eldest son, came running in to tell me the Penkiln was in spate. I looked down the garden, but because of the banking, couldn't see the river below and quickly dismissed what he'd said. Above, the skies were a blistering blue and not a cloud to be seen. But something niggled me, so I changed tack, took to my heels, ran down the garden, and sure enough, while the Cree beyond was hardly moving, save for the floating river weeds, the Penkiln was a muddy torrent. A sudden and distant thunderstorm in the hills was all it took to sweep away their dam and tear lumps out of the riverbank. Any child unaware of the things of the river could have been caught up in it with little chance of survival. I do hope in part it was my lessons that had paid off. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Graham. I'm not sure Chardonnay is seen as a key water safety aid, but nevertheless, I call Jackie Bailey to be followed by Ivan McKee around 4 minutes, Ms Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Claire Adamson for securing this debate and indeed for her helpful reminder of what to do if you get into difficulty. Drowning Prevention Week is particularly important to me as the MSP for Dumbarton, with an extensive coastline. And of course, I have both Loch Lomond and the River Leven within my constituency. I also represent Argyll and Bute, which has the second highest number of fatalities from drowning in Scotland after the Highlands. Sadly, Scotland has the highest rate of accidental drowning of all UK nations, and Water Safety Scotland reports that 62% of accidental fatalities happen at inland waters, such as those in my constituency. Now, in 2020, Ava Gray, a 12-year-old girl from Alexandria, tragically drowned when she slept in the River Leven. She was a much-loved, talented dancer with a bright future ahead of her, and her death was nothing short of devastating to her family and friends. And less than a year after the loss of Ava, Connor, a 16-year-old boy, died whilst playing with friends in the loch near Balloch Country Park. The following day, Adina, 29, Rana, who was just 9, and Mohammed, aged 39, died in the water off Pulpit Rock near Ardlui. Now, we know each death is utterly heartbreaking, and I would like to place on record again my condolences for the families of those who have lost a loved one through a water-based fatality. Ava Gray's family, Leanne Ray and Jamie Gillis, have campaigned tirelessly for better water safety since her death in 2020. And I pay tribute to them for doing so. It's not always been the easiest thing for them to do. Her aunt Jamie said, Ava went into the water right beside a life ring behind a locked gate. It would have saved her life, and I have no doubt about that. Leanne and Jamie's calls for action have not gone unanswered. There are now accessible life rings in several locations near to the water. And recently, pupils at secondary schools in West Dumbartonshire, who all knew Ava well, were given safety lessons to raise awareness of the dangers of swimming in open water. And these potentially life-saving lessons can and should be rolled out right across the country. In addition to this, on the shores of Loch Lomond at Balloch Park and along the River Leven, 25 additional public rescue equipment stations and location signs have been installed since 2021. These safety devices were funded by the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, but in truth, successive budget cuts have left the service struggling. Furthermore, these cuts have resulted in proposals to remove Polmadie Station's dedicated rescue boat crew, meaning the loss of 24-hour rescue boat crew cover for the River Clyde and surrounding areas. But even with the Polmadie Station boat crew on hand at full capacity, there are issues for Loch Lomond because the emergency response time to get a boat there is too long. That's where the efforts of Loch Lomond Rescue Boat are so important. They work so hard for the area, and I am grateful to them for all of their work. It's a charity, it's run entirely by volunteers, it's staffed by volunteers, and it's already facing a really busy summer, having had just 7 call-outs in a month, which is quite significant. Now, the rescue boats, we've already heard, does a truly incredible job, but it's not right that it should just be the main, if not only, source of resource, given that the loch itself is 39 kilometres long. That's a significant area to cover. And I've long believed that the fire service need to place a rescue boat at Loch Lomond itself, but I do recognise their important support for the Loch Lomond rescue boat. Education and knowledge of the dangers of open water are hugely important, but more lives will be lost if we don't have the necessary investment in safety equipment, rescue boats and staff. Presiding Officer, in closing, as we go into July and August, the months with the most accidental drowning fatalities, we need to firstly educate the population to swim safely in open waters, and secondly, we need to have sufficient safety measures in place should anybody get into trouble. Thank you.
Thank you, Dame Bailey. I now call Ivan McKee to be followed by Douglas Lumsden. In 4 minutes, Mr McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd first of all like to thank Claire Adamson for bringing this hugely important and often tragic subject to the Chamber for debate today, just after Drowning Awareness Week. I'd like to focus my brief remarks this afternoon on the Christopher's Saving Lives campaign. I met Christopher Spears just once, not long before his tragic drowning in the Clyde in 2016 at the age of 28, a young man with a bright future. And I cannot commend highly enough the work of his parents, Duncan and Margaret Spears, constituents of mine who I've watched and encouraged and supported over those long years as they've turned this tragedy as best they can into something positive, grabbing the opportunity to take forward this inspirational campaign, working hard with councils, with parliamentarians, with the government, with others right across the country to take forward concrete steps and measures to help reduce the number of tragic drowning accidents that occur in Scotland every year. Some successes have been achieved. They've designed and managed to get funded and installed colour-coded ropes in memory of Christopher that have been installed in the Clyde in Glasgow, where it's 10 deaths of savings of deaths have been attributed to that measure. Like 10 families otherwise would be going through the tragic experience of Duncan and Margaret. They've had measures installed on Loch Lomond, warning signs in parks within Glasgow, Alexandra Park and Springburn Park in the ponds. They are following up with work with Scottish Canals to install measures across along the canal in Glasgow and beyond, and they have real aspirations to expand all of this work further afield across Scotland. I know that Duncan and Margaret have met with Scottish Government ministers, and I'd really encourage the Minister to give some clear indication of further engagement with Duncan and Margaret in their campaign to further roll out those ropes and other signs and safety measures across other parts of Scotland, to provide counselling support for families that, like Duncan and Margaret, have been tragically affected by drowning, to help them overcome that tragic experience. To take measures to put together, as they describe it, a hard-hitting video on vandalism of ropes and life belts, which often unfortunately occurs, which of course can have tragic consequences if those measures aren't in place when they're needed. So I think all of those are very practical measures that can be taken forward. But I'd also like to again pay tribute to Duncan and Margaret. It's a real example of somebody who didn't ask to be in this position, obviously, but have done everything they can over a long number of years, often out with their comfort zone, but pushing very hard and relentlessly to deliver what they can, because they're driven to make a success of this campaign as best they can. Largely self-funded, which I know is a huge ask, and that there's work to be done to help them with fundraising so that they can continue to roll out this campaign. And I'd like to hear back from the Minister on the specific measures that can be taken to help their campaign as part of obviously wider drowning prevention work across Scotland. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr McKee. I now call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Fulton Gregor around 4 minutes. Mr Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, I'd like to thank Clare Adamson for securing this debate today on what is a serious and vital issue. I'd also like to commend the many organisations that do so much in promoting awareness of water safety and also provide practical help and training, so if someone does get into difficulty, they will have a better chance of recovering and avoiding a tragedy. Presiding Officer, I remember when I was a kid many years ago at school, and part of the school curriculum was being taken to the local swimming pool, it was Uptown Baths at the time, and being taught how to swim. I must admit I hated it. It was a freezing cold swimming pool that made my eyes sting, but it did teach me how to swim. And that is such a valuable life lesson. And to be honest, I have never been someone who enjoys swimming, but I know I can swim if I need to. And that gave me the confidence to go out on boats on holiday, always with a life jacket, I must add, and enjoy that fun that water sports can bring if done safely and carefully. But I was surprised when I started doing research for today's debate that so many of our school children were not learning to swim. 25% of children leave primary school unable to swim. But that in itself does not tell us the whole picture. I would imagine that in our more deprived areas, that this number will be a lot, lot higher. Because, Presiding Officer, as more of our public swimming pools are closing, more people will be turning to private pools and gyms to learn to swim. I must admit, I was lucky enough to join my local private gym, and both my children learned to swim there. But what happens for those who cannot afford the £150 plus per month for a family membership? These are the children who are missing out on a life skill that everyone should have. Yesterday, Olympic swimmer Duncan Scott wrote to the First Minister in protest of the closure of public swimming pools, telling him that pools boost fitness, health and safety. And I completely agree. This devolved government often talk about early intervention and prevention, but when it comes to health and well-being, it is all talk. Is it any wonder that our nation is becoming more unhealthy when these vital local facilities are closing, placing a much greater burden on our NHS in the future? Bucksbourne Swimming Pool in Aberdeen, where I represent, has recently closed its doors, an absolute shocking decision by the local authority that is now being taken to court by the local community as they fight to have the pool, the only one in the area that can be accessed by people with disabilities, reopened. Yes, I will.
Christine Graham.
I mean, this isn't party political, because in the Borders it's a Tory-led council and in Midlothian it's an SNP council. I commend both those councils when they're commissioning new schools and replacement, as I said in my speech, they make pools an integral part if there isn't one there already.
Douglas Lumsden.
I completely agree, but what I'm seeing is pools up and down the country closing down, and that was the point that Duncan Scott was making to the First Minister. So I would like to hear from the Minister what the Scottish Government are going to do about public swimming pools up and down the country closing down. And it's not enough for them to just pin the blame on local authorities that are seeing their budgets squeezed. If they value it and care about water safety, then they need to fund these local pools correctly. But, Presiding Officer, there is a potential lifeline. The UK Government announced additional funding for swimming pools back in March. £60 million of new money that would have helped our public pools to stay open. Of course, Presiding Officer, the UK Government could not give this direct to local government, as this would have been against the devolution agreement, and the money went to the Scottish Government instead. And as far as I'm aware, not one penny of this cash for swimming pools has been passed to local authorities to help keep pools open. So the Scottish Government have no excuses for pools closing. They were given the money, but shamefully decided to not pass it on. And no doubt we'll hear warm words from the Minister saying they are doing everything they can to reduce the amount of people drowning. But that is all it will be, warm words. If they are serious about reducing the deaths, they need to have more children learning to swim from all backgrounds. And for that, they need to stop the tide of public swimming pools closing. And for that to happen, they need to do the right thing, pass on the Barnett consequentials that were given by the UK government to local authorities to save our swimming pools. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. I now call Fulton McGregor to be followed by Paul Sweeney, up to 4 minutes, Mr. McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank my colleague Claire Adamson for bringing a really important debate to the Chamber, and I can't actually think of a better one to end the session on as we go into what could be a warm summer, we're all hoping. I want to speak in my time, Presiding Officer, about a couple of areas I've been doing some work on over the last year. And firstly, that's outdoor swimming, duking, call it what you want. There can't be a member now in this chamber, especially after the pandemic, that doesn't have a thriving group of dukers or wild swimmers in their own community. And I think that's as people have found the joys of outdoor swimming. And why not, as the benefits people are experiencing from this activity are in some cases extremely significant, and lots of reports around that. And there's actually science behind it too. A few months back, I had the pleasure of hosting an event with Dr. Mark Harper from Bristol University, whose research into cold water immersion on health conditions such as arthritis and mental health issues is truly groundbreaking. And this is perhaps why organisations like the fabulous Lanarkshire Counselling and CBT Centre in Coatbridge actually offer courses in a safe manner in cold water immersion through their service. But of course, with increased popularity comes increased risk. I don't think the strategy can just be to say, don't do something. Folk won't respond to that. We know that, particularly when they're finding that an activity brings such extreme benefits to their health. Now, I don't think we necessarily do just say no in Scotland. I've never found that from the government or from the organisations. But there is clearly a balance here between promoting an outdoor activity that has benefits and safety around water, which is, of course, a source of tension I've found for many agencies and organisations involved in swimming. Everybody wants to find that balance, right? And I think there is lots of ways that we can do this, and I welcome already, as Claire Adamson and others have said, the work of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, SEPA, and Scottish Water for their sterling work in trying to strike this balance and ensure people do follow proper advice. But also, as others have said, I do have to say there's another obvious way to ensure that we can make our water safer, and that's to ensure that swimming lessons and swimming pools are available across the country to a good standard. I know that not all people who drown, many of them can swim, but there is still a significant proportion that can. And I have been doing a bit of work with Scottish Swimming on this. On the 29th of March this year, I hosted a parliamentary event here at the Scottish Parliament, which was aimed at saving our pools. Scottish Swimming pools are under threat of closure. We're hearing that. We've heard that from other members. And inflationary energy costs, I think, are absolutely the main thing. And perhaps Douglas Lumsden would be able to speak to his colleagues down south about that. But combined with ageing venues and staff shortages... Yeah, no, it's fine.
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank Fulton McGregor for taking this intervention. Would you not agree with me, though, that his party often talks about the UK government should be doing more? In this instance, they actually have done more. They have gave money to the Scottish government. It's just that that hasn't been passed on to swimming pools.
Fulton McGregor.
Well, I thank the member for that intervention. My understanding of that is I don't think it's as simple and straightforward as that, and I don't think this is an area where we maybe want to play cheap politics in terms of that. I do think that the Scottish Government are committed to swimming pools, but as I'm saying, inflationary energy costs combined with ageing venues and staff shortages has led to a crisis in the leisure sector, and never has there been the need greater to highlight the importance of pools for safety, for health and for communities. I know that Scottish Swimming strongly believes that swimming pools are vital community hubs for the population of Scotland. Not only is water safety classrooms teaching more than 100,000 children each week the essential life skills, learning to swim, but it's part of the nation's health service, improving mental and physical wellbeing of all ages and abilities, which in turn save the NHS millions every year. Their petition has already achieved 8,664 signatures, and I hope to get a members' debate on the subject in the new term. I know that politically this is an issue that sits with local authorities, but going back to what I said to Douglas Lumsden there, I think we actually all need to pull together here, the two national governments as well as local authorities, to make sure that pools are safe and young people have access to them. I've asked questions in the chamber about making swimming lessons statutory as well, and while it doesn't seem like something that would happen just now, I'm pleased with the government's response and strategy that through investment from Sports Scotland, there is four swimming pilot projects where evaluation is ongoing about how we can take that forward. So I think we need to hear more about that. And when more and more people, as I've said, are entering the water for leisure, it is more vital than ever that swimming is again regarded as a life skill and not a hobby. Presiding Officer, I want to end now by paying tribute to two local 16-year-olds, Emily Dees and Lauren Campbell, who in December last year potentially saved a man's life when he fell through the ice into the Monkland Canal in Coatbridge while retrieving his dog. For this, they received recommendations from the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, Royal Life Saving Society, Water Safety Scotland and North Lanarkshire Council in March 2, and I'd like to add mine too here in the Scottish Parliament. This instance, however, illustrates the dangers of water and the importance of water safety strategies, and I again thank my colleague Claire Adamson for bringing it to the Chamber. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McGregor. And I call final speaker in the open debate, Paul Sweeney, up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I congratulate the member from Motherwell and Wishaw for bringing this motion for members' business today, albeit a week behind Drowning Prevention Week due to unnecessary constraints on parliamentary business, but nonetheless an essential and important topic for debate ahead of the summer recess, because we know the risks faced by our neighbours and friends and fellow citizens in this country from drowning, and we know that from what the member from Dumbarton said about it being the highest rate in the UK, is an acute issue we really need to get to grips with in Scotland. And certainly in my own area of Glasgow, we know that there are major risks associated with the River Clyde in the city. It might well be a famous waterway, produced great industrial benefits to the city, but it also presents a murkier and darker side behind its waters. Decades of neglect and a lack of dredging by the privatised Port Authority has resulted in a river that is indeed dangerous and in some instances very deadly indeed. Whilst last week was Drowning Prevention Week, it is an essential awareness-raising week that aims to educate people about water safety and drowning prevention, draw attention to the dangers of open water and equip people of all ages with the essential skills and knowledge to stay safe in and around water. And I think it was important, the points that were raised by several members today, Ms Gosell, Mr Lumsden, and the member for Coatbridge and Christen, about swimming lessons and school provision and access to municipal swimming baths. I think that is essential that we look at securing that capacity in Scotland. And I know that there have been cases raised about the costs of running it associated with heating and so on, but this is where we really need to get on the front foot with capital investment to introduce district heat networks and innovative ways of ensuring that these facilities are sustainable for the future. Yes, happy to give way.
Douglas Lumsden.
Thank the member for taking an intervention. Does he share my concern that there's a potential economic divide appearing, for we have people that can afford swimming lessons, that can go to private pools, and then there's no public pools left for everyone else?
Paul Sweeney.
I absolutely agree with that concern. Swimming, as we know, is the most democratic sport in Scotland. It's got the biggest participation, and it has, you know, the greatest balance across class and gender. So it is a very, very good way of people keeping fit, but also learning an essential life skill. And I think in that sense, it makes total sense for the government to look at the swimming pool provision closely. I certainly know in the Health and Sport Committee, we were looking at this issue, and around 90% of sport funding in Scotland is channeled through local authorities. We know they're under a lot of financial pressure. We really need to look at particularly capital-intensive facilities like swimming pools, ensure that we are making the modernisations to ensure that the running costs aren't becoming excessive and we can maintain them as viable public assets, because, like you say, the consequences, as the member says, are considerable for inequality and access to sporting facilities such as that, but also learning a critical life-saving skill. It would be appalling to think that that lack of opportunity could result in someone's death ultimately, and that's something we need to be cognizant of. I think I'd also like to echo the tributes played by the member for Glasgow Proven and the member for Motherwell and Wishaw about the Spears family and their courageous campaign in memory of their son Christopher, who was lost to the River Clyde in 2016, just at the age of 28 years. In particular, the innovation that they have been pursuing, not just to simply raise awareness, but also introduce practical interventions in our public realm to save lives. The co-design of the innovative floating safety rope with Ibex Marine in particular has been incredible to see happen. And that company support as well has been, you know, fantastic. It was interesting to meet with Duncan Spears, Christopher's dad, recently when he talked about how the workers at the factory have a photograph of Christopher up to inspire them to know that their work does save lives. And the rope itself has the colour yellow to be seen, orange for suicide prevention, and also purple, which was Christopher's colour. So that simple measure introduced following their campaign is estimated to have saved the lives of more than 10 people who have fallen into the Clyde, and I think that's an achievement they should be incredibly proud of. But the reality is, Deputy Presiding Officer, we need more than just improved safety equipment. We need dedicated 24-hour search and rescue cover on the River Clyde. And I was concerned to be contacted by firefighters recently who informed me that proposed cuts by the Fire and Rescue Service will mean that 24-hour rescue provision on the Clyde is now at risk. And that if rubber stamped, that proposal would see Polmadee's dedicated rescue boat crew removed from the station and replaced with a dual-crewed approach. Consequently, in addition to potentially 15 job losses, we'd have that dedicated boat crew lost because they would have to cover the fire engine and the boat as well. So with 22 rescues conducted by that crew in the last year alone, I call on the First Minister to make an intervention with the Fire and Rescue Service to stop this cut and ensure that capacity is maintained on the river. I hope the Minister will echo that call today and ensure that she engages across government to protect this vital life-saving measure on the Clyde. We cannot have a retreat in capacity for saving lives when we know it will make a positive difference because of government cuts. Not acceptable. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Sweeney. I now call on Siobhan Brown to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank Claire Adamson for raising today's motion, drawing attention to Drowning Prevention Week 2023, which helps to raise awareness on how people can stay safe in and around water and what to do in an emergency. And indeed, Claire Adamson, in her contribution, highlighted some of the stark figures on drowning. With summer upon us and the school holidays, it is timely to raise the profile of water safety and remind people of the steps they can take to keep themselves and others safe in and around water and what to do in an emergency. The Scottish Government is committed to continuing to work closely with all relevant organisations to explore opportunities to collaborate and to help reduce incidents. We want to raise awareness, particularly amongst those who are most at risk. Water Safety Scotland is a key partner in this work, and I would like to thank the Water Safety Scotland partners for their strategic approach, their work, and their commitment to making our waters safer. We recognise that, with the extent, nature, and the appeal of our seas, lochs, and rivers, water safety will always be a challenge and a priority. It is important to be aware that 90% of standing fresh water in the UK is in Scotland, with more than 27,000 lochs and more than 120,000 kilometres of rivers and streams. Mainland Scotland has 9,910 kilometres of coastline, and this increases of some 16,500 kilometres with many of our islands, which is 52% of the UK coastline. It's not just the extent of our waters that poses a challenge, but also their nature. Sudden changes in depth, which Pam Gossel alluded to in her contribution, deceptively cold temperatures and hidden currents can all mean that even good swimmers can get into difficulty very quickly. Activities in and around water are enjoyed safely and responsibly by the majority of people. However, in Scotland, we have an average of 92 water-related fatalities per year, which of around 50 are accidental drowning fatalities. The latest figures from the Water Accident Incident Database indicate that accidental drowning fatalities in 2022 decreased in Scotland, and this is compared to 2021, which was a particularly difficult year. These figures highlight the crucial collaborative work that our water safety partners are doing to help reduce the risk of drowning in Scotland, and their commitment to achieve Water Safety Drowning Prevention Strategy aims to reduce accidental drowning by 50% by 2026. I am very aware of the devastating impact that drowning has had on friends and family, and I will continue to use my role as Minister for Victims and Community Safety, as my predecessors did before me, to make it a priority to help reduce the numbers of drowning incidents in Scotland. in response to terrible tragedies in Scotland's waterways during the summer of 2021. The Scottish Government brought together key water safety organisations to collaboratively develop an action plan that promoted and aimed to improve partnership working, intelligence gathering and sharing, awareness raising, skills training and responses to incidents. The Water Safety Action Plan, which complements the important work of Water Safety Scotland, outlines the key initiatives to improve education, data, local area water safety planning and incident reviews. The co-designed action plan was published in March 2022, and the publication of the annual review and the update on progress 1 year on was published on Wednesday, the 21st of June, last week. This is now on the Scottish Government website, and there are some of the key highlights include that the membership of Water Safety Scotland has increased to 56 organisations who are now working collaboratively together to actively take forward water safety initiatives. Water Safety in Scotland's innovative drowning and review procedure was launched earlier this year. The review has been endorsed by all frontline rescue organisations and means for the first time partners are working together to review fatal drownings and to gather relevant data and intelligence which will help to develop measures to prevent future incidents and to identify high-risk locations. This pioneering work is recognised as a world first and has attracted attention from administrations as far as New Zealand. Age-appropriate educational resources have been developed for each education level from ages 3 to 18. This work, completed jointly with Education Scotland and Water Safety Scotland, is the first of its kind in the UK and now provides teachers with simple and effective tools to help educate children about how to keep themselves and others safe. I'll come to your point just in one moment. Around water, with a particular emphasis on the dangers of cold water, shock, and the importance on how to float to live. With summer upon us and people wanting to enjoy the good weather, it is important to remind the public to stay safe and follow the three-part water safety code. Stop and think, spot the dangers, stay together and stay close, and in an emergency, call 999. Now, I'd like to reflect on some of the contributions that we've had today in the debate, and I'll start with Doug Lumsden. I have been advised that the Barnett consequentials that you refer to have been given added to the local authority funding block, and the Scottish Government is working with Sport Scotland, local authorities, COSLA and the Scottish Swimming to understand the challenges that are currently faced for swimming pools and leisure facilities. Although it's important to know how to swim, yes.
Douglas Lumsden.
It's interesting that you say that it's already been...
Through the chair, please.
Sorry, Presiding Officer. It's interesting to hear the Minister say that that money's already been allocated because John Swinney actually had to correct the record back at the end of May when he made an intervention on myself and admitted that this was actually new money and hadn't been part of any money that had already been allocated. So is the minister sure that what she's saying is correct there, that this has been allocated? Because that's not what the former finance secretary seemed to say in my response.
Minister, and I can give you that time back.
Thank you. What I did say is a Barnett consequential have been added to the local authority block, and we are currently engaging on how we can work with swimming pools throughout... No, I'm moving on to other people. So... moving on to Ivan McKee and Claire Adamson mentioning Duncan and Margaret Spears' inspirational campaign about Christopher's campaign. I had the honour of meeting Duncan several weeks ago to find out about the work, and I'm looking forward to working together with the campaign and also writing to all the local authorities on his behalf to see what work can be done. Christine Graham gave her personal accounts of the dangers of rivers, and Jackie Bailey. I also want to echo all the condolences to the families who have lost people to drowning and all the great work that's been done at Loch Lomond with the rescue boat. To finish, I'd like to express my sincere thanks to all the partners involved, particularly Water Safety Scotland, for driving this important work forward. Your continued efforts to work collaboratively, providing time and resource, is greatly appreciated and is making a real difference. I'm very much looking forward to meeting many of the Water Safety Scotland partners when I attend the upcoming Water Safety Open Day at Helix Park on the 25th of July to support the UN's World Drowning Prevention Day. And with that, Presiding Officer, I close the last debate for the term. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I think that's probably my job, but that does indeed conclude the debate. I would like to congratulate members on making it through to the final item of business. I wish you a happy, restful and, of course, safe summer recess. And I close this meeting of Parliament.